In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you.
All right. Good morning. I just want to see if you guys could read lips. Good morning, everybody. It is Wednesday morning, September the 2nd, and we're expecting to have no internet outages this morning. So yesterday, about 15 minutes in so our internet was out, and they said it would be out until 2:43. So sorry about about yesterday. But let me say good morning to everybody. Good morning. Good morning, Mom. I love you. Good morning. Good morning to Sharon and John and Wendy and to Sonia and Naum and Sarah and to Kelly Kenfield. And good morning to Charlene, to Menyon. And if Rashad is with you this morning, good morning, or if he sees this later. Good morning to Ruti and Buenos Dias, Elva, in Mexico City. Good morning to Richard and Ellen and to Terry and Steve. Hope you are all doing well. And good morning to Pastor and Sister Martinez. Love you guys. And to Rebecca and to Cynthia and Andy and to Benjamin and Nathan and Caleb and Isaac and Lydia. Good morning to you guys as well. Good morning to Dee. Good to have you with us this morning. To Dee and to the Eddies, to Lauren and David and Levi and Valor and Haven and Everett. Good morning, you guys. I think that's everyone so far, I think. Let's see here. All right, so let's just jump right back in. I do have to catch us up to where we were yesterday. We had gotten through the first four verses or so, but we're in Jeremiah chapter 30. This next section is called the Book of Consolation. And it's likely that Jeremiah is writing this it's at a time where he's imprisoned, or it's, you know, just in the days leading up to, or the right leading up to, the Babylonian invasion of 586. It's a pretty dark season in Israel, and so in the midst of the darkest darkness, when it looks the worst, Jerusalem and Judah is about to get clobbered. There have already been two groups of exiles, of captives, that have been taken to Babylon. The Lord has told Jeremiah, has given him a vision in Jeremiah 24 about the good figs and the bad figs, right? And he, two baskets of figs. And the good news is that while he says the good figs are the ones that have gone into exile, the bad figs are the ones that will remain on the land. And the Lord had given him that vision, you know, at this point, 11 years earlier. And the beautiful thing is that in reality, what seems like bad news is actually good news, is that there's another group of exiles. So those who have been left behind at this season have an opportunity to be good figs, to respond to the word of the Lord. There's going to be another exile in 586, and what seems like the worst thing on the surface is actually the Lord doing a beautiful thing, setting aside the good figs, because he's going to cleanse the land, and then he's going to come back and he's going to replant, and he's going to do something new. And so over these last couple of months, as we've gone through these first 29 chapters of Jeremiah, most of Jeremiah has been him bringing a message to get the attention of the people, of terror and doom and violence, and it's all, you know, it's not been a message of peace and shalom. Well, so now the Lord, and when the Lord called Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 1, the Lord had said, you know, that I've called you to tear down, you're going to tear down, to destroy, but then he also says to plant and to build up. And so now these words in these next chapters are words of planting and building up. And the one thing you got to keep in mind as we go through these next chapters is what's going to become abundantly clear to anyone who has ears to hear is that the comfort, the words of consolation to a shattered people of Judah are in fact words that have a deeper, richer, fuller meaning. So yes, they have immediate impact to the people that it's being spoken to in their context. But the Lord, who is able to work in a multidimensional way across the ages, who is able to work all things together for good, even in the midst of our rebellion, in the midst of what we're doing, that the Lord is making all things new. And that's what he began to do right from the moment that there was, that we fell in the garden. And so, you know, the picture I have, I've got one little toy this morning, but is this idea of, like, this would be Jerusalem and Judah and Israel, that this is what God is doing, you know, and he's doing this it's a microcosm. It's a small level of a bigger thing that he wants to do, that the Lord has a plan that's for all humanity, you know, for Jerusalem and Judah, and then to Samaria, and ultimately to the uttermost parts of the earth, right? So what God is doing on a small level is in Judah and among the people of Judah, and what you see happening in Judah is ultimately a picture of what he is intending to do for all humanity. And what we will see in these passages is that, again, it has immediate application for those in the midst of the darkest time. It has immediate application for the exiles, but God's doing something on a grander scale. He's doing something much larger, and so we actually begin to see his plan, but eyes are veiled. They can't see it. Jeremiah and the people at that time are not able to anticipate all that the Lord is going to do. They don't understand about Yeshua, about the suffering servant yet, about the ultimate Messiah. Their focus is still on the 18-year-old king, for instance, that's been taken into exile. But that's not the king that the Lord is going to raise up. And so there's this passage that you know, if there was ever a conversation in Scripture that we could be transported to listen in on, that we're told about, this would be the one. It's in Luke chapter 24. Luke 24, verses 25 to 27. It says, Yeshua said to them, to these men walking on after his resurrection, these men walking on a road to Emmaus, and they don't really know who he is, and he said to them, O foolish ones, so slow of heart to put your trust in all that the prophets spoke. Was it not necessary for Messiah to suffer these things and to enter into his glory? And verse 27 says, then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them the things written about himself in the scriptures. And so that conversation, I've always been like, man, I wish they would have spelled that one out. I would have really loved to hear everything there. But I am convinced that these passages in Jeremiah are passages that Yeshua would have pointed to, that would have shown, he would have pointed here over what we'll see today and in the coming days, is Yeshua right in the midst of these passages and coming through our darkest season. So yesterday we read where it says, verse 1, the word came to Jeremiah from Adonai, saying, thus says Adonai, the God of Israel, write all the words that I have spoken to you in a scroll. So again, he can't necessarily declare. Normally the Lord tells him to go and speak these words, but here at this point, the Lord instructs him to write all these things in a scroll. And verse 3 says, for behold, look, hine, the days are coming, or days are coming. There's an indefinite aspect to days are coming. Days are coming, declares Adonai, when I will return my people Israel and Judah from exile. There's a day that's coming. Days are coming when I will shuvah, shavtei et shavut. I will turn their captivity. I'll return them from their captivity. I will bring them back to the land. I will shuvah. I will return them to the land I gave their fathers, and they will inherit it. They will possess it. So the Lord he's pointing, the days are coming. This is not the end. Jeremiah sitting in a prison, likely because of the word of the Lord, and impending doom. And in the midst of that, the Lord says, behold, days are coming when I'm going to return the captives. I'm going to return and I'm going to build up here. But before that can happen, because everything that's happened, this all the judgment that's happening at this moment in Jeremiah chapter 30 is something the Lord kept saying, this is coming, this is coming. Turn to me, call on me, it's coming. And so the word of the Lord is true. He's slow to anger. He is patient, not wanting any to perish, and yet his word comes to pass. And so now the reality that his word, even of judgment, is coming to pass gives us a sense of hope, because if he has a word of judgment that is indeed coming to pass, then when he says there is another side, there's hope on the other side of this, that you can take that to the bank as well, that you can be assured in the midst of the darkness. He said, this is coming, right? Yeshua said in Matthew 24, I tell you all of this stuff is happening so that when it occurs, you'll know that I'm at work. And so, you know, a lot of people, you know, when you tune into Christian television or whatever, they take the book of Revelation as like it's a mystery book, like a Sherlock Holmes, that they're a novel, that they're supposed to figure out all the things. And it's not told to us so that we can predict and anticipate all of it. It's told to us so that as it occurs, when it comes, yeah, we can study that book and know that book and seek to understand. But it's likely that on the other side is when we begin to go, oh, this is what was happening. I thought this, but now that it's occurred, I see the Lord knew what he was doing all along. So I think there's much there that we will understand as it occurs. And it's a confirmation in the midst of the darkness that, yes, the Lord is on the throne. And so before that hope can come, the cleansing has to come. His work of discipline has to occur. So now these are the words that Adonai spoke to Israel and to Judah. So now this is important because the Lord is not speaking simply to Judah. This is to the whole of his people, to Jacob, to Israel, to the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The northern kingdom in 722 was taken into captivity and scattered. And the southern kingdom has now been taken in waves. And this is now the third wave in which they'll be being taken into exile. Verse 5, for thus says Adonai, and I think this is about where we were, by the way. Okay, well, we were coming to verse 6. It says, for thus says Adonai, we have heard. You know, they're being taken into exile, the Lord says, because you did not Shema. The last time he spoke to Israel and Judah combined was in Jeremiah chapter 13. And the Lord says, you were supposed to be a praise to me, a glory. You were supposed to be, you were supposed to cling to me. But because you did not obey the word of the Lord, you didn't, and obey, it's the word Shema, because you did not hear and heed, you did not do what you heard, because of that, now this judgment is coming. And so now instead of having heard the word of the Lord, what we're hearing, we have heard a cry, a sound, but the word is kol, like a voice of trembling. And the word there for trembling is charad, fear, anxiety, terror. It's not like a shaking, it's a trembling. It's a fear and anxiety. What we're hearing is a voice of terror, a voice that's terrified, of dread. There is no shalom, ain shalom. There is none. Shalom, there's none. What we're hearing is not the voice of the Lord. We're hearing the voice of cries of terror. And what we're hearing, what we're hearing are cries of dread. There's no shalom. That in the midst of this right now, so then the word of the Lord says, verse 6, ask now, inquire, please, he says, sha'alu na, please, inquire, ask, and see whether a man can give birth. So why do I see every man, and the word for man there is gever, a strong man, like a warrior. Why do I see every man with his hands on his loins? Like a woman giving birth. Why have all faces turned pale? So the Lord here speaks not sort of as some distant observer, but rather that he stands in the midst of this chaotic scene, asking, what's going on? Do you guys notice? Somebody ask, why is this happening? What's going on around here? I don't understand. Do men, there's a level of irony, a little bit of sarcasm. Can men bear babies? Because they're all in the posture of giving childbirth, which the posture, which I don't need, is different in the ancient world than anyway. You know what I'm talking about. There was a different posture of giving birth in those days. They're all leaned over. Will someone explain why does it look like these tough? Can they give birth? Because it looks like all these tough guys are going through labor. And their faces are pale. Blood has left their faces. It's speaking of total fear. All the tough guys, the strongest among you are totally helpless. They're totally vulnerable. Like a woman in her most vulnerable place, overcome with fear, pale-faced, crying out to such a degree that if you didn't know any better, that these guys are giving birth, you'd think these guys are giving birth. Verse 7, oy, for that day is monumental. That day is gadol, is great, it's huge. What's happening here is a big deal. There will be none like it. This day, there's nothing like this day. A time of trouble, tsarah, a time of trouble for Jacob, of distress for Jacob. So again, for all of Israel. Yet out of it, yet from it, he will be saved. A time of trouble for Jacob, yet out of it, from it, he will be saved. So this is one of those verses in Jeremiah that sort of has a life of its own, reaching far beyond the 6th century. People have written articles and books on this verse but the emphasis when everyone writes about this book is Jacob's trouble, Jacob's distress. And so everything typically written is discussed on the nature and the extent of Israel's suffering. And future as it is how it's considered. But the thing that's interesting to me is that the main focus, the main theme in the verses here is that from trouble, deliverance is coming. That great blessing follows that time of suffering. It says this day, this darkest day, is a big day. There's no other day like it. It's the darkest day, a day of trouble for Jacob. And then the last sentence is just, it's really just two words in Hebrew. It says, imana Yeshua. Yet out of it, Yeshua. Yet from it, in the midst of Jacob's trouble, from it, from this darkest day, Yeshua, salvation, deliverance, hope. There's this picture, right? Of men, of the strongest of men, in such agony, as groaning as in the pains of childbirth. In the midst of their most unimaginable anguish, and yet, what is coming forth from this, what's coming from the earth groans, and from it, salvation. Out of it, Yeshua. In the immediate context, in the immediate, right? You're looking at the destruction in the immediate context. This is the destruction of Jerusalem and Judah. It's the wiping of the land, as it were, the suffering of the exiles, Jacob's trouble. But that's not the story. That's a microcosm. It's a picture of ultimately something much larger, much grander. Because the story doesn't end. It doesn't conclude with rubble and ashes. The story doesn't end with Jacob's trouble. The story ends with a rebuilding. The Lord has said, I'm going to bring you back from your exile. The Lord had called Jeremiah to uproot, to tear down, to destroy, to overthrow. But beyond that, after that, he is appointed to build and to plant. God's final word, God's ultimate purpose, is not to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow. God's final word is to build and to plant. Its restoration is Yeshua. All of this is necessary. The agony that you see, the pain, this darkest of days, is necessary for what is to come. From out of it, Yeshua. What we see here is the immediate prophecy, yes, regarding the present crisis. But it's pointing to something bigger. As with Judah in their day, we're always focused on what's going on in our immediate context, in our immediate crises. And the Lord will deal. He's speaking to them about their immediate crisis. But he's dealing on a much grander scale. that the Lord is working in the midst of our present crisis to do something that we can't begin to imagine. All that they could focus on was, when will the exile end? And that's all they could see. In the words that he was speaking, they could still only see how it was going to affect them in the immediate. What they didn't see was that God was doing something at a level that they couldn't begin to comprehend. All along, the Lord is working multidimensionally across the ages, making all things new. There's an agony, the earth groans as in childbirth, a consequence of the fact, right? The earth groans. The world is crushing itself. Nations rage. The people's plot to overthrow the one true king, the God of Israel. They seek to overthrow. Psalm 2 talks about God's rule. And yet, in the midst of all of that, that's all because from the very earliest days that we didn't Shema, right? We're in exile. The earth groans as in the pains of childbirth. These men are in agony as in the pains of childbirth because why? Because we didn't hear and heed. We didn't Shema. And from this destruction, there's hope, Yeshua. So we see the picture of the immediate exile, but we can also see in principle what God was doing in all humanity, right? The big picture of all humanity. That all humanity has been in an exile. Exile from the garden. Exile from the walking with the Lord in the cool of the day. Exile for all who have been made in his likeness. Exile from being able to fully accomplish what he intended for us to do. When we were made, the scripture, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no mind has conceived what God has prepared for those who love him. We have no idea of what eternity will hold. We have no idea of what God's original plans were for humanity made in his image. We don't fully grasp that. Everything fell, and so the Lord is working to make all things new, to bring things back to ground zero. Everything fell. He's bringing it back just to ground zero, to where we were in the garden. And then from there, we can't even begin to conceive. What could we possibly do? What could be our purpose in eternity? I don't understand. So we only envision playing harps on clouds. But no mind has, God has always been working to bring us out of exile back into that place of relationship with him. He is working. He's revealing that our ways, right, when we don't Shema, when we couldn't even listen, we couldn't even listen to the one command, or really the two commands, right? The command in the garden was actually a positive command. Of all the trees in the garden, eat, 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 eat. He says it twice, so it's translated, you may freely eat. Like, manja, manja, right? Eat, enjoy, but of the tree that's going to open your eyes to evil, I don't want you to taste that. So trust my word. Just listen to what I say. I've come to give you life and life abundantly. Of all the trees, eat, eat. Just don't eat from that tree. And what we key in on is what we can't have. And rather than recognizing that he has told us this for our good and for... So whether it was one command, two commands, or 613 commands, we focus rather than on the blessing, choose life, that you and your children may live. We end up experiencing the exile and the curse of not having Shema. All humanity is in exile. Yet from it, yet out of it, Yeshua. Because of God's nature, because of who God is, that he is overflowing in chesed, he's overflowing in truth, that who he is, the Lord, is gracious and forgiving, overflowing in chesed, overflowing in truth, his kingdom is founded on righteousness and justice. He's forgiving of iniquity, and yet by no means does he hold the guilty unpunished, he says. His whole heart is always wanting to restore, yet out of it, out of your deepest darkness, Yeshua, salvation, deliverance. This is the moment Jeremiah is writing his scroll. It's the worst day. It's a bad day for Jacob. The worst ever, none like it, it says. But out of it, Yeshua, out of it, hope, out of it, deliverance. So check this out, verse 8. It will be in that day. Haya bayom hahu. It will be in the day, that one. In that day, declares Adonai Tzevaot. We need to get this. In that day, that I will break, shatter, shavar, I will break his yoke from off your neck. In the day of the deepest darkness, in that day, in the day when they're coming in to take you, in the day, Jeremiah, when you're imprisoned, in that day, not after that day, but in that day, I break the yoke of the off your neck and will tear off your bonds. And there's a violent, the Lord is freeing his people in the day of the deepest darkness. Foreigners, Zurim, will no longer enslave him. And it gets, so you, the language there, you'll no longer be servants, avad, worshipers, servants, slaves to these outsiders. In that day, in the moment you think it's your worst, the very season of your deepest darkness, when you've reached the end of yourself, when you finally hit rock bottom, and you wake up to, we have done this. Babylon is coming in. We are crushed. The Lord has already said, lower your neck to receive my discipline, because in that day, if you receive it, in that day, that's where you find freedom. When you recognize that all of your own ways result in this disaster. I did this. I need you. And in that day, he says, I will break the yoke. You are no longer, though you are being taken into captivity, you are not captive. Though you feel captive, though you're in chains, in that day, I am breaking your chains. It's this principle of the now and the not yet. What's happening now is I'm being carried off in captivity, and yet I'm free. Because what he said, it's as though it's already been done. I am free in that very day. There's so much more work at work here than exile. There's so much more at work than just the condition of Judah and Israel. The Lord is speaking to a deeper condition, to the condition of that is at the heart of all that God is trying to accomplish in the entirety of his creation, to make all things new, to restore us to who he, to transform us, to reform us to who he made us to be. When humanity fell, right, a plan was put in motion for God to restore all of us to himself. Israel was chosen to be a light to the nations, but they failed to walk in God's ways. But even so, the purposes of God will not be thwarted. What the enemy intends for evil, God will use for good. And he can take what was not his will and still rework it. People think that the will of God, everything that happens is the will of God. Everything that happens isn't what God wants. It's not the delight of God. When you and I sin, when we rebel against him, it's not like, well, it must have been God's will. No, it's not. But he can take us asserting our own wills, and he can take the disaster we've made that looks irreparable. And that's what later tomorrow we'll look at, is this irreparable wound. And he can take it, what seems beyond repair, and he can still recraft it to accomplish his purposes, to accomplish his ultimate will. And so the Lord is working in the midst of Israel's disobedience. He didn't want them to go into exile. He begged of them, choose life that you and your children may live. But still, he still, through this punishment, through this, from this salvation, from this deliverance, that he's going to work all things together for his purposes. God's purposes won't be thwarted. So the Lord, through Israel and Judah, will accomplish his purposes, the purposes that he has had all along for freedom and restoration, for deliverance and salvation, for Yeshua. And there's a picture here in this passage, right, and all of this, of the cross as well, this darkest of days. That in the moment of the darkest day, Yeshua is bearing our judgment, right? He's carrying our judgment. That in that moment, people often think that it's in the resurrection that we're free, but it's actually in the moment of the discipline, when Yeshua took upon himself the discipline, the chastisement, the instruction, the rebuke, painful rebuke, the crushing rebuke for our sins, in that moment, is where our freedom lies. And the coming from the resurrection is the return from the exile. Coming back from the grave, coming out of death, from the grave, from the tomb of exile, is a confirmation that he has set us free. But it was on the cross. Colossians 2:5 says, after disarming the principalities and powers, he, Yeshua, made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in the cross. In that day, freedom. In that darkest of day, out of it, Yeshua. In that day, I will break his yoke from off your neck and will tear off your bonds. Foreigners will no longer enslave him. Verse 9, instead of being the slaves of outsiders, instead of being slaves of the enemy that you were never intended to be under, instead, they will serve Adonai, their God, and David, their king, whom I will raise up for them. So there's this new deliverance from Egypt. Once, remember, when we go through the Passover stories, we were avadim. We were slaves of Pharaoh, but now we are avadim, servants of the Lord. And the difference in terms of being avadim between a slave and a servant has to do with who the master is, right? It's the same. I'm going to be a servant. It's one or the other. I'm going to be a servant to Pharaoh, or I'm going to be a servant to the Lord. One or the other. And it's just the condition is based on who you're serving. And so now we've gone, and again, now we, instead of being slaves of this outsider, we will be servants of God. And the Lord has said, and multiple times in Jeremiah, no longer will be said the Lord who brought us up from Egypt, but rather it will be said the Lord who has delivered us from the north, that this will be our new story, our new testimony, our renewed, because we were born into the condition we were in Egypt. But now, even from the place that we are there because of our failure, because we were given, when we went into Egypt, we didn't have the instructions of the Lord. When we went into Egypt, we didn't have the Torah. We found ourselves there. We didn't know better. The Lord actually allowed us to be in that place, led us there. But now we are in Babylon of our own doing. And even from that if you humble yourselves, the Lord will restore you. And he will bring you, if you'll submit yourself to what he's doing, he will restore you to the land, to the inheritance that he has for you. And the Lord says here, I will raise up David, their king. But this is not a promise about the 18-year-old king. Jeconiah, Jehoiakim, or Coniah, whatever you want to call him, this is not a promise about him, because through Jeremiah, the Lord has already spoken of him in Jeremiah 22, the back end of verse 30, speaking of Jehoiakim, said, for no man of his seed will prosper, sitting on the throne of David and ruling again in Judah. So God's already said that about Jeconiah. So the Lord's talking about something much grander here when he says, I myself will raise up the king. Will raise up the seed of David, David their king. On this day of darkness like no other, the day of Jacob's trouble, from this, out of this, Yeshua. Out of this deliverance and salvation. In that day I will break off the yoke of slavery. In that day I will break off the yoke of the one who has had you. I will break your chains. In that day, and I will raise up David their king. Man. Verse 10. So now, and it actually just, it says, and you, is what it says, ve'ata, and you, do not fear Jacob, my servant. So now again, he says, Jacob, my servant. So he's speaking on a grander scale. He's not just speaking to Judah and Israel. He's talking about something, about a restoration that is just, it does extend now beyond Babylonian captivity. Now, the early readers would have thought that perhaps the Lord is talking about the return even of the northern kingdom from their exile, from having been scattered by the Assyrians. But the Lord's talking about something much grander. He says, you, Jacob, do not fear Jacob, my servant, says Adonai, nor be dismayed. Don't be terrified, O Israel, for Hineni, for behold, ki Hineni, for behold, look, I will save. And this word here is from Hoshiana, Moshiacha. It's I will save you from afar, from rochich, from a distant place. I will, Yeshua, I will save you, restore you from the far reaches of wherever you've gotten. I will gather you back. I will restore you from afar, your seed, your zer, your descendants, your seed from the land of their exile. So yes, it's talking to the seed of Judah, to the seed of Jacob, to their descendants in exile. But there's a picture here too of the seed of humanity in exile. That this is a grander picture of the Lord saying, I am working to restore all humanity, the seed from exile, from captivity. Jacob again will be quiet, shachat, and at ease. He'll be quiet and untroubled and at ease, he says. And no one will make him afraid. Right? So at the beginning of this, because they didn't hear the word of the Lord, what could you hear? You could hear the voice of trembling, the voice of anxiety. In the word charad, the voice of anxiety is all you could hear. Ein shalom, right? No peace. Back in verse 5. What do I hear? Listen now, what do I hear? I hear this, the cries of anxiety and no peace. But when the Lord's done, he says, and that day Jacob will again be quiet and at ease. So he gives this picture of shalom. Right now there's no ein shalom. At this point, there will be ein macharid. There will be anxiety, fear, the same word. There will be none. Right now, you hear cries of anxiety and no peace. There will be peace and no anxiety. There's this like a palindrome, like a bookend between from what we broke, right? So that what we did brings cries of anxiety and no peace. And then he will raise up a king, and the result of what he will do will be peace and no anxiety. And it's bookended by that. Isn't that it's just beautiful. And so the day the Lord says, I will save you, your descendants. Verse 11, for I am with you. It says, for with you ani. For with you I am. And there's that emphasis, ani, me. Declares Adonai, to save you, lehoshiacha, to rescue you. For I will make a full end of the nations where I will scatter you, but I will not make a full end of you. For I will discipline you justly. And the word there for discipline is yasar. I will rebuke you. So by the way, in Isaiah 53, when it says that he bore our, talks about the suffering servants, as it says the chastisement, that made us whole, that gave us peace. That chastisement is the same word, yasar. He says, I will discipline you, chastise you justly, with justice, with mishpat, but will not leave you unpunished, will not leave you guiltless. So that Yeshua himself is the one who takes upon, he takes on the justice, the mishpat of God. He takes on our chastisement that made us whole. For those who faithfully walk with the Lord, those who are his servants, there is hope in the midst of the crises and the catastrophes that will befall the nations, both in the days of the 6th century BCE, at this time of Jeremiah, and in the distant future. The Lord is at work. His justice will be accomplished. His mercy is overflowing. There will be they will not go unpunished, but neither will they be completely destroyed. They will return to their rest and have no reason to fear. Anyway, so that's the verse 11 verses, and we'll pick back up tomorrow continuing through from verse 12 on, and we'll continue to see more of what the Lord is doing, more of how Yeshua out of this darkness, Yeshua. All right, well, let me say good morning to everybody that I may have missed. Good morning to Jim and Sarah and Nicole. Good morning to John and Jan and to Lori and Pat, to Willis and Deanna, to Elizabeth. and Jesse and Salome and Philip. Good morning to you all. Good morning to Alice present. Good morning to you as well. And Sonia Valenzuela. Good morning to you, Sonia. Buenos dias. Let's see here. We've got Kelly Woods watching and Jim Cannon out in Napa watching. How you doing, buddy? So Jim and Jerry, love you guys, and I hope you're doing well. All right. Well, we'll see you tomorrow. Excited to continue through this book of consolation. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shalom, shalom. Have a beautiful day. Oh,